Hey, you guys, this is Mr. Sal. I'm gone, so Sub will be showing this video. If the Sub needs help, please go to Mr. Woolley next door to the north, and he should be able to come over and help you out. So you guys take a moment, start on the bell work. We'll show you the answers to the homework. Even though I'm not there, we won't take scores, of course, but we will next time. But I'm not going to show you the slides, so if you need them, you can just watch this video, which I will be putting on Canvas anyways. By the way, you guys, don't mess with the Sub, please. If I get any bad reports, trust me, I will make you pay for it. You just won't know until, probably at the end of the year. So please don't make life hard on them. They're doing their best to try to make up for me being sick today, so I appreciate their help. So be good. If I get any bad reports, I won't tell you that I got a bad report. But some of you may just be wondering why the heck you have so many quizzes and tests for the remainder of this term. And there are the answers. And here's the first slide. Notice on 3B there are 27 points. So you will need to check all of those. You should have them all 27. They're all different. There you go. And here is the second page. All right, sub, this is a good time to have the worksheets passed out, please. The TAs can do that for you. They are the yellow sheet. It's a yellow packet, actually, for 7th grade. The homework will be the green paper, which you'll pass out when the video is complete. All right, with the horse race game, remember if you rolled on one dice and rolled the second dice, we added the two numbers together, and that gave us the number of the winning horse. So take a moment and fill in the table based on those rolls. So the column here on the left represents the results from roll one, and that represents the roll two. And when we add those values together, for example, this one would be 1 plus 1, which gives us a total value of 2, and that's the number I would put here. This box right here is 1 plus 2, so we'd put 3, 4, 5, 6, and 7, and that completes that first row. So go ahead and complete the rest of them. And there is the completed table. Now, it seems like we talked about this already, but what is the number of the horse that is most likely to win? I'm going to take a moment and figure that out. If you can find the probabilities for all of these, that'd be good too. So clearly horse 7 is the sum that occurs the most often. It occurred 6 times out of the 36. The 6s along this diagonal right here only occurred 5 times. The 5's 4, the 4's 3, the 3's 2, and the 2 1 time. If we look at the 7s, of course, they are all 6. And on the other side we have the 8s, which occur 5 times, the 9's 4 times, 10's 3 times, and 11's 2 times, 12's 1 time. So of course the 7's are the most likely, they're the ones that will occur most often in this theoretical probability. So how many times did that horse's number occur in the table? And we can see it shows up, the sevens show up 6 times. So what is the number of the horse or horses that are least likely to win? Well, we've got this 2 here and the 12 here. Both of those occur once. So it looks like it is horse number 2 and horse number 12. And how many times did those horses occur in the table? Well, it was just once, one time. How many total outcomes are there altogether in the table? So we're just going to count those squares. And we can see that there are 36 outcomes. This is a 6x6 table. We do not include the gray column and row because those were the results from a roll of the dice. What is the probability that horse 8 will win? Well, we can see right here, here are the eights. And how many of them are there? There are 5. How many possibilities were there? 36. There were 36 outcomes. So yes, the answer is 5/36. You should also be able to write that as a decimal and a percent. The table shows the probabilities for each horse winning. Recall, this is called the theoretical probability of winning because we're not actually racing any horses or rolling the dice. Mathematical notation, we can see P of horse number 4 wins, but we can just write it as P of 4 right here. And for 4 was 3/36, which we could simplify as well. And you will have to simplify in order to get the points on a test. So let's look at those probabilities as a fraction and a percent. Go ahead and fill that in on your table on the worksheet. And here is the table again, just in case you need it. So take a moment and just add up all the fractions and figure out what the total is also. And add up all the percents in the table and find that total as well. Both of those should come out to a very specific amount. So here are our fractions, and I know you guys hate fractions, but the nice thing about all of these is we kept them in their original form without simplifying them, and so when we add all of these together, we should get 1, because you would have 36 over 36. If we added all the percentages together, therefore, all of them should add up to 100%. Now, it is okay if you're off by a tenth or a hundredth, depending on... Well, more like a hundredth, I guess, in this case, because of how you're rounding, maybe. So just be careful with that. So if there are 200 races, or if we're rolling the dice 200 times, how often would you predict horse number 7 would win? So this is kind of what we did last time. Go ahead and take a moment to do that as well. So what they're trying to show here is actually just a proportion, specifically the percent proportion, which we set up this way, and horse number 7 had a 17% chance of winning right here, and that goes just above the 100. Now we are looking at 200 races, that's the whole value, so that's all of the races, 200. We want to know about how many times horse number 7 would win out of those 200 races. So if we do use fishy method or bow tie method, whatever method you wanted to use, you should get about, well, really it should be 34 races. I don't know where they got this from. So I'm going to say this is 34 races. Now let's say that we race the horses 500 times. What is your prediction for how many times horse number 7 will win? Again, this is all based, these are predictions based off of the theoretical probability. So once again, they have that 83.33 times. Well, again, I would be looking at setting up the percent proportion like this. And when I do, I really should get about 85 races is how many times horse number 7 would win. Now, if you do put 83.33 because you based it off of the fraction, that's still okay. So part B, 1,000 times, if we race them 1,000 times, how many times would we expect horse number 2 to win or horse number 12? Well, we can see we would expect them both to win about 28 times. One way to look at that is to multiply this 3, or just put it in a percent proportion, I guess. 3 over 100 equals X over 1,000. So if you put 30, you'd be fine as well. Now, part C, suppose we watch the horses race 500 times. Which of the following values would be most likely result for horse number 5? So horse number 5 should win, since it's 11%, that's about 11 out of 100 races. If we multiply that by 5, we should get about 55 wins. The closest value to that is this 50 wins right here. So we would expect the horse to win about 55 times. But the closest result for that is this 50 wins. Probability models, like tree models, like the one we used last time, shows the outcome of random processes. A probability model includes the following: a listing of the sample space, all the possible outcomes. For example, you can use set notation, which we're not really going to do. We usually will be using a tree diagram or a table. Depending on the situation, a tree diagram is good if we're doing something more than once. So twice, I should say. A table is good if we're going to just do something twice, usually. Otherwise, it has to be multi-dimensional. Probability for each possible event in the sample space. Remember, probabilities always add up to 1, which is a good way to check our answer. Suppose you're going to toss a coin and see how it lands. List the sample space using set notation. So it looks like we have to use set notation here. First thing we need are our fancy brackets, like this. Now we're tossing a coin. What is the result after one toss? Well, you can either get heads or you can get tails, and that's it. So we're going to close that off with another set of fancy brackets. What is the probability for tossing a head? Well, we have two possible outcomes. One of them is heads. What is the probability for tossing a tail? Well, you have two results, two outcomes. One of them is tails. Now we list the sample space last time in a list, but this time do it in set notation, all right? And then find the probability of each of the eight outcomes. And there you have it. Should have all eight of those, and the probability of each of those is equally likely, so it is 1 out of 8. Now you should have this already in your notes, but create the tree diagram again to represent this sample space. All right, now notice the way that we did it is we didn't actually have this line here, and that's okay. You don't need it there, all right? But this represents the results of the first toss. The second toss after the first toss, though, okay? So even though it's heads and tails for heads on the original and tails on the original first toss. So the other great thing about this is it shows all eight of the outcomes and the possibility of each of those happening. We haven't gone over these fractions yet, but we will very soon. So let's go ahead and use the list or the tree diagram for three coin tosses to fill in the theoretical probability of the following events. We have three heads, three tails, two heads and one tail in any order, and two tails and one head. So this one is saying at least two heads. This one is saying at least two tails. Go ahead and take a moment and solve that. All right, so there's our outcomes. To get three heads, that's this outcome, which is 1 out of 8. To get three tails, that's this outcome, which is 1 out of 8. So those check off. Then for two heads and one tail, let's go ahead and look at that in green. So I have two heads and one tail right here. Here, this one has two heads and one tails. Same with this one, and that's it. So that's 3 out of the 8 total outcomes, which is represented right here in the fraction and decimal form. Of course, you should be using the percentage as well. So what about this 2 tails and 1 head? Let's go and look at those. There's 1, 2, 3. So 3 out of the 8 possible outcomes have 2 tails and 1 head in any specific order, which again is shown in the table. So looking at this notation right here at the top, the probability of TTH is the same as saying the probability of tails on the first toss, tails on the second toss, and heads on the third toss. So knowing that, let's go ahead and take a look at these probabilities, compare those with the tree diagram, and then solve for those probabilities using percents, decimals, and fractions. Alright, so let's take a look. After one toss, the probability of heads. We've already done that one. It was 1/2. Tails also 1/2. Well, what about heads and tails? That was out of 4 possibilities, and only one of them was heads, tails. Tails, heads also 1/4. Heads, tails, heads is shown in the table right here. And that is shown as 1/8. And tails, tails, tails also 1/8 probability. A compound event is an event made up of 2 or more independent events. We'll fill in the blanks for calculating probabilities for compound events for 2 or more events occurring together. So sometimes we'll be rolling a dice and then tossing a coin. Sometimes we will toss a coin and then spin a spinner. Sometimes we'll just spin a spinner 3 or 4 times. You just never know. We've already done tossing a coin 4 times, which also is a compound event, because it includes 2 or more independent events, which would be tossing the coin independently each time. Now, to solve for probability of compound events, what you do is you take the probability of event number 1, And then you, if you have the probability of event number 2, you can multiply those together in order to find the compound probability. If there was a third one, then you'd find the probability of the third event and also multiply that together, okay? And this may show up as probability of 1 and 2 and then number 3, just so you're aware of that on the test or the homework. And this is one of those examples, okay? So we're going to say that the first event is A, the second event is B, and the third event C, and so forth. So we're just saying they're different events. But if I say that the probability of A happening is 50%, and the probability of B, event B, is 50%, then what's the probability of event A and B happening? Well, it's kind of asking us to compare this, the probability of heads, and then the probability of tails, okay? Just to compare. So the probability of heads was 1/2 and the tails is 1/2. So when we look at this, it's really the probability of A times the probability of B, just like it was with heads and tails. Well, that's 0.5 times 0.5, which is 0.25 or 1/4 or 25%. Now, let's look at the second question. If the probability of A is 0.5, probability of B is 0.5, and the probability of C is 0.5, again, the probability of A, we're going to multiply that by the probability of B, and multiply that by the probability of C. So we have 0.5 times 0.5 times 0.5, which would come out to 0.125, or 1/8, or 12.5%. Now go ahead and use your words and symbols. State your conjecture. Just write a sentence or a general rule for calculating the probabilities for independent compound events. Use the rule you found in the prior question to calculate P of heads, tails, heads, heads, heads. Well, we remember the probability of heads is 0.5. Some of you would rather work with this in fractions, and that's the way I'm going to do it. The probability of tails also 1/2. So this really is the probability of heads times the probability of tails times the probability of heads, times the probability of heads, times the probability of heads. And let's replace those with the actual values as fractions like we have up here. And all of these are 1/2. We're going to multiply all these together. And 1 times 1 times 1 times 1 times 1 is 1. 2 times 2 times 2 times 2 times 2. Looks like that's 32. So the probability of heads, tails, heads, 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 and we'll write that out, probability of heads, tails, heads, 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 is 1/32. Now let's suppose that we have an unfair coin, so the probability of heads is 0.8 and the probability of tails is 0.2, which you should be able to change those into fractions if you really want to. Well, the probability of heads, again, is 0.8 because it told us right here, and the probability of just tails is 0.2 because that's what it said right here. The probability of heads tails, though, is the same as the probability of heads times the probability of tails happening. So we have 0.8 times 0.2, and that gives us 0.16. The probability of tails heads is the probability of tails times the probability of heads, which is 0.2 times 0.8, and that gives us the same answer, 0.16. So the probability of heads tails heads is the same as the probability of heads times the probability of tails times the probability of heads, which we have those three right here, and they gave us 0.128. So the probability of tails 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 is the probability of tails times the probability of tails there, and those as decimals are 0.2 times 0.2 times 0.2, which again you can put this in the calculator and it will give you 0.008. So how are the calculations from that activity similar or different? All right, Sub, thank you for teaching the class. Go ahead and hand out the homework worksheet, which is green, for the 7th graders. If they were misbehaving at all, please make a note of that, and I will deal with them accordingly when I get back.